Ladies and gentlemen, you have locked into Rap Life. We're going to talk to Low Key. We're going to talk to Nadeska. What are the most important conversations that are going on in hip hop right now, as well as run through some of the hottest songs on the playlist. So y'all keep it locked right here. This is Rap Life. First, let's talk about Wet.
Shmear, shmear, shmear.
You could have just went with record. WAP. That was also an option. You know that,
yeah,
right?
WAP was fine. Just could have said WAP.
Nah, man, nah. So, Nadeska, a lot of amazing reviews and mostly positivity, but out of the woodworks comes the, you know, fun police who try to act like nobody's naughty and nobody has sex. Talk about this record with Megan Thee Stallion and Cardi B, what you saw, and how you feel about some of the negative energy around of it.
I think the negative energy is not surprising, but guys, we love hip hop. We've been listening to it for decades and we already know what it is. It's very explicit. Like I was reminded during the X and Snoop verses, like we saw with Rick Ross and 2 Chainz. So there's always a double standard when women do it, but these women in the video clearly do not care. They feel very empowered. So it was really dope to see them have that moment.
I saw a lot of sexuality. I saw a lot of uncomfortable men on the timeline, watching Cardi, watching Megan, watching their friends tweet, you know, lyrics from the song, post clips from the video. I saw women empowerment, and you know, men love to get in their feelings when we can't control how we sexualize women. And I told people, I'm like, yo, go listen to Slob on My Knob. Go listen to Back That Thing Up. We've been doing this for about 30 years. You know, the funny thing about this is when WAP dropped on Friday, people were like, yo, you should make a playlist of like the nastiest rap songs. And I'm 25 songs deep right now. First song was WAP, obviously. And then we got Slob on My Knob by 3-6, Pussy Poppin' by Ludacris, Getting Some Head by Shauna, My Neck, My Back by Kaya, Not Tonight, Lil Kim, Freaky Tales, Too Short, Freaky Girl, Gucci Man. It's so many songs that we have that you cannot get upset about. And like I said, when men can't control women's sexuality, they have a fit. And we saw that all throughout the weekend. The only bad thing is we couldn't go to brunch to watch them do it in person.
So let's go a little bit deeper. Let's go a little bit deeper since you brought up men and control. Most of us as men were raised by, you know, our mothers, and many of us have fathers, but too frequently, too many men don't have fathers in the home and a trustworthy male to look up to. That happens too frequently. But let's just focus on men, how they view their mothers and how they view their daughters, and how society has sexualized us to view women through this narrow lens, leaving out how either our daughters got here or how our mothers got pregnant in the first place. And not that it was, you know, necessarily this X-rated, you know, I don't know what your mamas was into, but as always, when you bring up somebody's mamas and you remind them, hey, yo, fam, you judging these ladies and their sexuality, but how do you think your mama got pregnant?
During that round table, so it was Cardi B, a couple of the girls from the video, and this is part of the discussion they had, how when women are very open and explicit about their sexuality, especially once it's visual, some people can get extremely, extremely uncomfortable with it. Sookie, you mentioned that you have 3 kids. I don't feel like hip hop is a space where, you know, a woman can feel comfortable being pregnant or talking about something like that and being open about raising her family. But again, you know, boundaries you guys are breaking down. What does it mean to you guys being able to raise your family and still be liberated, like you said?
People be lying. I'm telling you, people be lying. People be saying they don't like and they don't like that talk. People love it. People
love it.
They love it. Because I know, yes. I know a lot of female rappers, they be talking about, you know, the community and the unity, and they're very woke. And it's just like, there are really good rappers, but it's like, y'all don't be streaming them. I mean, like, people always have accused me, because I was a dancer. Everybody always used to say, like, it's like, she 100 before. She I never these. Well, y'all met me. I had a fiance, and now I have a husband. So yeah. People just always be assuming because you talk about you that you be in the world.
Their theory also, and you guys tell me this as men, is that you secretly love it. but you outwardly just feel the need to, and not you specifically, obviously you're very progressive men, that most men actually really enjoy this, but they feel a need to put down women publicly for it.
It stems from what we were just talking about with social programming and the social programming that women are supposed to be ladies in public and you can be a freak in private. But it also, you know, is perpetuated by a patriarchal society of men that, once again, to Low-Key's point, is accustomed to determining about saying who gets to have the power, right? That's one thing about society. Society is about power in many ways, but one of the powers is determining who gets to have what power. Men oftentimes, or most of the time, or in history, all the time are the ones paying sex workers. You know why sex work exists and men went out and paid for it? Is because they were married and part of the contract, verbal contract or assumed contract, was they could pay for something and thus keep their other needs met privately, and they could do their debauchery, you know, in the shadows. You know what I mean? And that's what the strip club culture and all that was built on, was men sitting up in there being not being able to live out their sexual fantasies at home, but being able to live it out in the shadows. You understand? So all of this shit is woven into the hypocrisy of our society. I just every single time, and by every time I mean I've been here since 1990, so seeing this, whether it was from men, and it was Al Sharpton and C. Dolores Tucker stomping on CDs and saying shit was too raunchy, all the way to, you know, Little Kim hardcore. You know what I mean? And there's tons of women rappers who have embraced sexuality.
I think that, you know, with Cardi right now, Cardi's just unapologetically sexual in herself, you know. Coming up from the Bronx, very just blunt and blatant with everything she does, but her sexuality just oozes out. And I believe, you know, Megan is the same way. And for those two to come together in this moment, especially what Megan's going through, bringing her back under the world, you know, Cardi putting her under her arm, like, I got you, we're gonna do this together and we're gonna have fun and we're gonna f his heads up. You got politicians tweeting them. You got insecure men tweeting them. They did their job. You know, they did their job. They came to do what they were supposed to. I'm not sure if Cardi's got a new album coming out or whatever the case is, but they made a statement and they shook up the, you know, they shook up the weekend, they shook up the world. And, you know, I love to see it. I would love to continue to see more.
So I think it's very interesting that you guys bring up this idea of what the traditional, you know, what the relationship is with your wife and being able to go out and live this separate life with sex workers and in the strip club. And Cardi talks about this in it, you know, just the way people stereotype her because she's a dancer. Meanwhile, she is married with a child. You know what I mean? So it really flips this whole idea on its head. And I think to you guys' point, that's what's making people so uncomfortable. Being a wife and a mother does not mean that you have to be this very buttoned up, prim person. Cardi is still going out and making a lot of money for her family and inspiring a lot of young girls. So I think it's great. And I love that she and Megan and all the girls who cameoed in this video feel no fear when it comes to that, because the pushback and the backlash can be pretty intense, but they don't care. And I love it.
You had a Republican candidate, two Republican candidates tweet about Cardi B. But I don't think these people have learned from history, because the more taboo, the more you try to like treat sexuality as if it's, you know, some sort of forbidden feeling that humans shouldn't have, it becomes the thing to do. Especially amongst people who are young, trying to define their sexuality and trying to find their place and what they feel is in enjoyable in society. So I think, you know, a lot of these idiots need to look back at history and let people live life and let people find their path, as long as they're being safe and not being abusive with their behavior. Rick Ross and 2 Chainz went down last week. An enjoyable moment had by all. Speaking of strippers, they had some.
I like that everyone is now trying to up the entertainment value, right? There's been kind of an arc. I feel like at the onset, Verzuz felt a lot more competitive. Now it's feeling more like a celebration, sometimes some friends vibing. But for this one, I feel like they wanted to up the entertainment value. My personal favorite part was Rick Ross dancing and him getting the massage during Verzuz. I feel like it just perpetuates this like boss, you know, caricature he's had going on forever.
Showmanship aside, you know, 2 Chainz bringing money for Ross, bringing the strippers, you know, drinking a tequila, him performing over TV tracks made it feel like a concert.
Son, the Rick Ross massage, big, and the outfit change.
I love that. Outfit change was pristine.
Yo, you wasn't here for the massage?
No, I watched. I'm not. I just, it got too much. It's like, all right, enough. This is cool. 5 minutes. Boss lifestyle, luxurious, cool. But now it's like.
They went full oil down. He got the oil.
Bro, I saw his mind going somewhere else. That aside, the music, you know, me and my boys were having a conversation over the weekend about Ross having so much to pull from puts him at a handicap because his music, club, radio, luxurious, trap, hood, it kind of is difficult for him to put 20 together. 2 Chainz had 20 records that had plaques, multi-platinum, club bangers. I feel like in that setting, 2 Chainz got the upper hand because we knew exactly what we were getting when we heard 2 Chainz records, whether he was on the hook, whether he was doing the verse, whether it was his record, whether it was a remix. Ross's catalog is just so, you know, broad that you can pick from. So 2 Chainz won to me.
Yo, Ross won by at least 3 rounds on my count.
At least 3 rounds?
At least 3. Minimum 3 rounds he won by.
It's so hard to compare. Like, he played Aston Martin music, and then here goes 2 Chainz playing f***ing Problems. So it's like, what's the scale of judgment?
For me, it was what I prefer. And also, when you compare those two records, 2 Chainz only had the hook on f***ing Problems. Aston Martin music was a full Ross onslaught. You see what I'm saying?
Right, but what was it, a hit?
What? Aston Martin music?
Aston Martin music, yeah.
Yes, yeah, so, I mean, at Hot 97 in New York, it was.
I would consider it a hit. Low, you don't?
Nah.
Now, I had a conversation with Ross on Hot 97 on my morning show there. Ross says he's prepared for a whole other battle. Ross said, I didn't even get to some of my hammers. I left a lot on the table, and I got a whole other 20 ready and loaded for another battle.
I came with a cool 20 pack and got 20 more for somebody else to really step up and say, and I'm going to play 20 different ones.
All Ross is saying in that clip is, for 2 Chainz, this is what I prepared, and I'm ready for whoever else wants it because I got more bangers. That was light work for me. That's how I took it. I took it as basically slander towards 2 Chainz, if you want to be honest. Swizz alluded over the weekend to a Drake Kanye West versus battle. Do you see a day, Nadeska, where this could ever actually happen?
I think Kanye might actually be down. When we're talking about this realm of rappers, people throw out the Coles, the Kendricks, people who we think never would. Kanye is the only one that I could see waking up one day and deciding to make this a full-blown production. You know what I mean? But Drake, I don't think Drake is ever going to play ball, especially since him and Swizz just had that little issue. I was surprised to even hear Swizz suggest this.
I see it the opposite way. I see Drake engaging. I see Drake having fun with it. I see Kanye, his ego, stopping him at the front door and not letting him do this because he's, so quote, you see, unquote, a genius.
You see Drake, because even in the battle rap scenario, he showed up to some battle raps. Like, he shows up for the culture in some ways.
Drake is an avid fan of, you know, the Smack DVD battles and, you know, all that stuff. So I see I see him engaging in this. Do I see Kanye having an actual moment of, like, you know what, let's have some fun? Or
fun.
Do I see Kanye's...
No one's talking about fun here. Now we're back to versus being competitive.
My fault. Now it's competitive.
Let's
okay.
Let's be honest, friends. Let's be honest. Kanye is obsessed with Drake. He's obsessed with this man. He cannot stop tweeting about him. He's talking about him in interviews. It seems like he lays awake in bed at night thinking about Drake. I think he might consider this as his one chance to prove that he's still
this
better.
This got crazy. I give you this. The one thing that I think stands in the way, not of the battle happening, but of them actually getting through 20 songs, is Kanye West and his mouth. He won't go 3 songs without derailing the whole thing into politics, anti-abortion, him and Kim's relationship, his gap out, sticking up you know, fashion people for contracts. He won't make it five songs.
That's what I'm saying. His ego, his mouth is not going to let him get past two records.
And not only that, gonna get annoyed. I think it would be very irresponsible, just like I think other things are. And I know you can't stop someone who's an adult that is dealing with mental health from doing what they want to do unless they're harming themselves or other people. I know that's a thing. But I think it would be very irresponsible to put someone where Kanye is right now dealing with these things in public on this kind of platform in hip-hop, which is relentless on social media.
And they're going to destroy him.
It will be relentless.
So yeah, I don't want to personally, musically, yes, I would like to see it. Personally, I know what that storm is going to end up looking like if it does happen.
Now, Lo, you said you believe Drake would show up for something like this.
Yeah, I think Drake would.
Is that because we will see a Drake album pretty soon?
Oh, I don't know. I mean,
and this aligns with his promotional window of, you know,
well, you,
Khaled
you see
songs,
how act, you see,
being
yeah,
on
you see
Pop
how active
Con.
He is. Yeah, you see how active he is. I think there's something coming. I do believe there's something coming. He's getting his reps in. He's more visible. So, yeah, by summer's end, fall, going into fall, we'll have something.
Hey, yo, you're listening to the Rap Life Review. We are here every week. Make sure you subscribe, man. Subscribe, Rap Life Review. See y'all next week.